Hello guys! Today I will show how to implement the distributed configuration pattern using Spring Cloud Config and a combination of a Git repository and a Vault server. I will just ask you to subscribe to my channel and let's go! To use Spring Cloud Config, I need to configure both the server and the client. In a traditional application, both the code and the configuration are stored together. With the help of the Spring profiles, I can select a different configuration for the development environment and for the production environment. Nevertheless, most of the configuration refers to the infrastructure. The infrastructure may not have the same lifecycle as the application. So why to store the configuration for the infrastructure next to the code? With a distributed configuration, the application at the startup will download the last version of its configuration. It will be downloaded from the configuration server. This one will be linked to a source folder where the configuration files will be stored. The source folder can be a simple folder, a Git repository, a database, a Redis server, or more. This way, the configuration files can be updated easily without the need to change the application. This means that I need a new project. New project? Let's go to Spring Initializer. Add the dependencies of Spring Cloud Config Server and the actuator. I don't need more. Let's unzip the file and open the project. First thing to do, in the main class, add the notation to indicate this is a config server. I will also add the following annotation to read the application names from the service discovery. Now, configure the server. Specify the default port used by the server and a different context path. Enable the actuator endpoints. Indicate the service discovery URL. Specify the name of the application and where to locate the Git repository with the configuration files. If needed, I can specify the username and password to fetch the changes from the repository. Now, move the configuration files from the other projects to this Git repository. I've renamed the application YAML to the name of the application. The same name specified at the Sprint application name. The same name used in the service discovery. Nevertheless, there is one configuration which will remain in the projects, the Spring application name, obviously. I will show how to bootstrap this configuration in a moment. But now, let's see how the server returns the configuration files to the project. Config, which is the context path I've set in the config server, the name of the client application, the profile of the application. I can specify a different profile at the startup of the application to target a different configuration file. I may have a development profile and a production profile. If I want to use the profile, I have to add it to the name of the file, service user production YAML, or service user development YAML, or service users to target the default profile. And I can have an additional label. It's optional. In the case I use a Git repository, the label will be the branch to check out. Here is the configuration file from the config server. Cool, config server ready. Let's continue with the clients. I need to add two dependencies. To specify the application to read the configuration from the server, to allow the application to read the configuration from a Bootstrap file. Why do I need this Bootstrap file? When starting a Spring Boot application, it first loads some preliminary bins, then reads the application YAML to configure the remaining bins. But in my case, I don't want those preliminary bins to be loaded with the default values, because I may have some specific values for them. The Bootstrap context will load a Bootstrap file with the initial configuration. There will be located the URL of the configuration server. This way, the remote configuration will be downloaded at the very startup of the application. This is not the case for older versions of Spring Boot, where the Bootstrap context is loaded by default. What does this file look like? Nothing more, the URL of the config server and the name of the application. Let's start the application to see how it fetches its configuration. As you can see in the logs, one of the first lines shows it's communicating with the config server, and the application seems to start correctly. Okay, I could end the video now, but having the username and the password of the database stored clearly in a Git repository is far from being a good practice. Where should I store my credentials? Let's use Vault. Vault is a key value storage system, which encrypts everything at storage. It's a very good option to store credentials, passwords, or secrets. I specify which key I want to store. Let's say my username, I pass the value, and my authentication token. Nobody, unless they're admin, can now read this information. Even other users of the Vault won't be able to read my username without my token. So now I must configure Spring Cloud Config to read from the Vault server and from the Git repository. But having two sources, I must now specify the priority. As I store the most critical information in Vault, this will be the high priority. Even if Spring Cloud Config finds the credentials in the Git repository, they will be overridden by those coming from the Vault server. Here is my Vault server. Let's add some credentials. I can read them now, without the token because this is just a development purpose server. Now remove them from the Git repository. And finally, configure the config server to have the two sources. The profiles will indicate which sources are available to be read. I have to specify the version 2 if I am using a recent version of Vault. I will use the authentication via token. There are about 10 more different types of authentication. Let's restart the config server and start again my microservice. It started correctly. Read the configuration from the server at the beginning and configure the database connection correctly. Job done! Having the configuration separated from the code allows me to perform some modifications easily to my application without the need to redeploy a new version. I can even configure the client to accept a hot reload of the configuration to allow me to modify on real-time some parameters. That's all. Don't forget to thumbs up, to subscribe to my channel, and see you in the next video. Bye!